Hello everyone, today we are going to see the next topic in unit number 5. The name of the unit is transmission lines. In this unit, in today's session, we are going to see other parameters related with transmission lines, and also we are going to see Smith chart. In today's session, our topics will be lossless transmission line, VSWR, Smith chart, impedance matching. Myself, Professor Amit Kumar Mishra. I am having total 10 years of teaching experience, and my domain expertise is 10 years. Analysis of lossless transmission line. To minimize the power loss on the line, R is equal to 0 and G is equal to 0, because power is lost in the resistance of two conductor and conductance of the dielectric separating the two conductor. Gamma is equal to under root of J omega L, J omega C. So, inside the under root J omega will be 2 times, so we can take it outside, so gamma will be J omega under root of into under root of LC. Z naught is equal to under root of J omega L upon J omega C, so that will be under root of L by C. It should be noted that for a lossless line, gamma is purely imaginary and characteristic impedance is purely real. So alpha is 0, beta is omega into under root of LC. In practice, we do not find a lossless line. However, we get low loss transmission line. A line is called low loss provided it has R very much less than omega L and G very much less than omega C at the frequency of operation. The line parameter gamma for a lossless line can be written as gamma is equal to alpha plus J beta, that is equal to under root of R plus J omega L into G plus J omega C. If I take J omega L outside from this and J omega C outside from here, so I'm going to get gamma is equal to under root of J omega L into 1 minus J R upon omega L into J omega C into 1 minus J G upon omega C. So this J omega L into J omega C, I'll take J omega outside, it will be under root of L C. And in bracket, under root of 1 minus J R omega L into under root of 1 minus J G upon omega C. Since R by omega L are G and G by omega C are very much less than 1, expanding the brackets binomially and retaining only first order terms, we get gamma is equal to alpha plus J beta, that is given by this equation. So finally, we will get gamma is equal to this one. Separating the real and imaginary parts, we get attenuation constant alpha is equal to R by 2 under root of C by L plus G by 2 under root of L by C. And phase constant beta is equal to omega into under root of LC. It can be observed that phase constant of a low loss line is same as that of lossless line for a given L and C. The use of alpha is made only in power loss calculation. In practice, if the condition alpha is very much less than beta implies a negligible reduction in the wave amplitude over one wavelength distance on the transmission line. If we substitute gamma is equal to J beta in the equation of general transmission line, then we will get the voltage of the equation of voltage and current as shown over here. Now let's see about the reflection coefficient, equation of reflection coefficient. This is the equation for reflection coefficient. If I substitute gamma is equal to J beta, then I'm going to get reflection coefficient for a transmission line of length L is equal to ZR minus Z naught upon ZR plus Z naught into e raised to power minus 2 J beta L. Next is voltage standing wave ratio. The maximum and minimum peak voltages measured on the line are Vmax is equal to V positive into 1 plus reflection coefficient, and V minimum is equal to V plus into 1 minus reflection coefficient. Let us define a quantity called voltage standing wave ratio, VSWR, as it is the ratio of voltage maximum upon voltage minimum, or VSWR is equal to 1 plus reflection coefficient upon 1 minus reflection coefficient, or reflection coefficient in terms of VSWR will be reflection coefficient is equal to VSWR minus 1 upon VSWR plus 1. In telecommunications, standing wave ratio is the ratio of amplitude of partial standing wave at an antinode maximum to the amplitude at adjacent node minimum in an electrical transmission line. VSWR is accurate indicator of reflection coefficient on the transmission line. Vmax is very much greater than Vmin and VSWR is always greater than 1. It could be infinity when Vminimum is equal to 0. Since VSWR is 1 corresponds to reflection coefficient as 0. Similarly, for VSWR infinity, reflection coefficient will be 1, that means full. For efficient power delivery to the load, VSWR and reflection coefficient should be as small as possible. VSWR is equal to 1 corresponds to maximum power transfer, and VSWR is equal to infinity, no power delivered to the load. Return loss and reflection coefficient. Return loss is defined as return loss RL is equal to 20 log of reflection coefficient. Return loss indicates the factor by which reflected signal is downed compared to the incident signal. For perfect match, reflection coefficient is equal to 0 and return loss is infinity. Whereas for worst case, reflection coefficient is 1 and the return loss is 0 dB. Higher the return loss, better is the match. For acceptable value of VSWR is equal to 2, reflection coefficient is equal to VSWR minus 1 upon VSWR plus 1, which is equal to, for VSWR 2, we can write over here 2 minus 1 upon 2 plus 1. So reflection coefficient will be 1 by 3. Therefore, return loss will be minus of 20 log 1 by 3. That will be 9.54. So return loss should be higher than 9.54. Impedance variation on the transmission line. Maximum impedance occurs where the voltage is maximum and current is minimum, and its value is ZL max is equal to V max upon I min. That is equal to Z naught into 1 plus reflection coefficient upon 1 minus reflection coefficient is equal to R max. Noting that quantity inside the square bracket is VSWR, we get R max is equal to Z naught into VSWR. Similarly, the minimum impedance occurs at a location where the voltage is minimum and current is maximum. ZL minimum is equal to V minimum upon I maximum, which is equal to Z naught into 1 minus reflection coefficient upon 1 plus reflection coefficient, that is equal to R minimum. R minimum is Z naught upon VSWR. Voltage standing wave ratio. The voltage standing wave pattern provides immediate information on the transmission line circuit. If the load is matched to the transmission line, ZR is equal to Z0, the voltage standing wave pattern is flat with value V positive magnitude. If the load is real and ZR is greater than Z0, that is characteristic impedance, the voltage standing wave pattern starts with a maximum at the load. If the load is real and ZR is very much less than Z0, the voltage standing wave pattern starts with a minimum at the load. If the load is complex and imaginary part of ZR is greater than 0, that is inductive reactance, the voltage standing wave pattern initially increases when moving from load to generator and reaches the maximum first. If the load is complex and imaginary is less than 0, capacitive reactance, the voltage standing wave pattern initially decreases when moving from load to generator and reaches a minimum first. Let's move towards some graphical representation. Here we are going to see, after this few slides, we are going to start with the Smith chart. So basically, in graphical representation, we take any quantity in complex form. Suppose any quantity is there like 1, 0. So 1 will be the real and 0 will be the imaginary. The same is shown over here. Graphical approach for transmission analysis, Smith chart. Smith chart is one of the most useful graphical tools for high frequency circuit applications. The chart provides a clever way to visualize complex functions, and it continues to endure popularity decades after its original conception. From a mathematical point of view, the Smith chart is a 4D representation of all possible complex impedances with respect to coordinates defined by complex reflection coefficient. Domain of definition of the reflection coefficient for lossless line is a circle of unitary radius in the complex plane. This is also the domain of Smith chart. In case of general lossy line, the reflection coefficient might have magnitude larger than 1 due to the complex characteristic impedance, requiring an extended Smith chart. On a Smith chart, we are having some circles given. Basically, there will be two lines. One is real, another one is imaginary. As I'm moving the cursor, you can see over here, this is the real line, this is the imaginary line. Now you can see over here, there are a few circles which is cutting the real axis at some point. So this point is r is equal to 0, this point is r is equal to 0.5, this is r is equal to 1, r is equal to 5, and so on. So this is for the real axis. Similarly, we will have separate lines for imaginary also. Let's see that. So for imaginary, we have these lines which are on imaginary axis. So for x is equal to 1, these are the different values of imaginary lines which will be written on the Smith chart. So x is equal to 0.5, x is equal to 0, x is equal to minus 0.5, x is equal to minus 1, x is equal to 1, and all. This one thing we have to keep it in our mind is above the real, half part of the real, imaginary value will be positive, and below the half part, imaginary value is negative. Basic Smith chart techniques for lossless transmission line means what kind of things we are going to do. So the things will be like, we had been given with ZT and we have to find out the reflection coefficient, or we had been given with the reflection coefficient and we have to find out the impedance. Similarly, we have to find out Dmax and Dmin. We have to find out the voltage standing wave ratio, that is VSWR. Or we had been given with impedance and we have to find out the admittance, or vice versa. These are the some steps. Or if this impedance is given, then how to find out the reflection coefficient. Let's take an example to understand this. We have to find out the reflection coefficient. We had been given with admittance, which is 25 plus J100 ohm, and characteristic impedance Z0 is equal to 50. So what is the very first step? First step is we have to find out the normalized impedance. So how to find out the normalized impedance? So normalized impedance is ZD upon Z0. Means we had been given ZD as this, and what is Z0? 50. So our normalized impedance will be 25 plus J100 ohm divided by 50. So it will be 0.5 plus J2. So normalized impedance will be 0.5 plus J2. So on Smith chart, if you see, this 0.5 is real value and 2 is imaginary value. So this 0.5 is cutting the real axis and 2 is cutting the imaginary axis. So you can see here, we'll get a point over here. So this will be 0.5, 2. So we have to measure the distance of this point from one point, which is on the real axis. And what we have to do is, on the lower side of the Smith chart, we had been given with the scale of reflection coefficient. So while keeping the at the center, we have to cut mark on the left side the same distance which is over here. So that point, this point, will be our reflection coefficient. So in present case, it will be 0.8246. Therefore, our reflection coefficient is 0.8246. An angle will be what? From this to this, that will be the angle, which is 50.906. Now we have been given with the reflection coefficient and we have to find out the impedance. So how to go with that? Let's see. Let's take an example to understand that. We have been given with ZR and a characteristic impedance. You have to find out the ZD, means after certain distance, what is the impedance and reflection coefficient, and distance is 0.18 lambda. So what we have to do is, if you find out the normalized impedance, then 25 plus J100 upon 50. So it will be 0.5 plus J2. So this thing which is given in the previous case, it is same. So what we have to do now is, in the previous case, this distance we have to measure. and we have to draw a circle of radius this much and center at 1. So we have done the same. We have taken the center at 1 and we have drawn the circle. Now, this we have to draw a straight line which will cut this point, which is the point for normalized impedance, that is 0.5 plus J2, and we have to stretch this line till it cut the last circle. After that, we have to note this point in terms of lambda we will be getting over here. So we have to add 0.18 lambda into that. So if we do that, then we will find that that point will lie somewhere here. So again, what we have to do, from 1, we have to draw a straight line which will cut the whole circle. Then we have to note down the coordinates of the point where it is cutting this circle, inner circle. So that will be your ZD. What is ZD? Impedance for a distance of 0.18 lambda. So for our case, ZD is 11.79 minus J of 59.6 ohm. And we know how to find out the reflection coefficient. It's simple, like we have to measure this distance. On the below side of the Smith chart, this scale is given. So you have to keep that at the center. And this much distance we have to cut on the left side on the reflection coefficient scale. So that where the point where it will cut, that will be your reflection coefficient. Now, how to find out Dmax and Dmin? It's simple. Like in this present case, we had been given with ZR. Two ZR has been given. One is 25 plus J 100 ohm. Another one is 25 minus J 100 ohm. We had been given with Z naught is equal to 50 ohm. So how to find out Dmax and Dmin? Let's see that. So it's simple. Like if I draw, I took ZR as 25 plus J 100 and Z naught is 50. So normalized impedance will be 25 plus J 100 divided by 50. So it will be 0.5 plus J 2. So that point will lie somewhere here. From 1, we have to draw a straight line that will cut the outer circle. Now, there is an angle in the circle. So we have to just note that angle. So from the center to this, that will be your particular angle. So that angle will be 50.9. And there is another circle which will give you the reading in terms of lambda. So that will be the distance. So that point we have to note down. It will be, for this case, that will be 0.0707 lambda. So that will be our D max. Now how to find out D min? So what we have to do is, this lambda, what we got, we have to add 0.18 lambda into that. If we do that, then we will be getting 0.3207. Sorry, we don't have to do in that way. What we have to do is, this Dmax we are getting is 0.0707 lambda. Then to find out Dmin, this half part, that will be 0.25 lambda. This half part is 0.25 lambda. This half part is 0.25 lambda. So it is 0.5. Whole circle is of 0.5 lambda. So this half part is 0.25 lambda. So we have to add 0.25 lambda into 0.25 lambda into this Dmax. So that will be 0.3207 lambda. It will be Dmin. In this way, we have to find out Dmax and Dmin. The same thing I've explained over here. If we had been given ZR as 25 minus J 100 ohm, so the point will be lying below because imaginary is negative. So normalized impedance will lie somewhere here. Again, we have to do the same. This distance from this axis will be your Dmin. And add 0.25 lambda into it. So that will be your D max. So that will be from here to here. Now, how to find out VSWR? VSWR means voltage standing wave ratio. We know that VSWR is Vmax upon Vmin, or it is 1 plus reflection coefficient upon 1 minus reflection coefficient. Let's take an example to understand this. It's very simple. Suppose we had been given with ZR as 25 plus J 100 and Z naught as 50. So we will find out normalized impedance. So for this case, normalized impedance will be 25 plus J 100 upon 50. So it will be 0.5 plus J 2. So that will be lying somewhere here. So while keeping this much of distance, while and taking the center at one, we have to draw a circle. And on the right side, where it will cut the real axis, that point, that value will be nothing but VSWR. In our present case, it is cutting after 5 here, it is 10.4. So this VSWR will be 10.4. Now, if we have been given with the impedance and we have to find out the admittance, so how we can do that? Note, the normalized impedance and admittance are defined as Z and D is equal to 1 plus normalized 1 plus reflection coefficient upon 1 minus reflection coefficient, and admittance is opposite of that. That means it is 1 minus reflection coefficient upon 1 plus reflection coefficient. Now, graphically, step-by-step procedure is as follows. We'll take an again example to see how to find out admittance. ZR is 25 plus J 100 ohm with Z0 is equal to 50 ohm. See, in the question, if you find normalized impedance, it will be 0.5 plus J2. So this point will be 0.5 plus J2. Now, if we draw a line which will cut all the circles, means passing through one to this point, as well as stretch it, that line downward as well as upward also. So on the downside, wherever it will cut this circle, that point will be normalized admittance. So for our present case, normalized admittance is 0.11765 minus J of 0.4706. Now what we have to do is, if you multiply this with conductance, then that will be our admittance. But in our present case, we had been given with, you know, characteristic impedance. So what we have to do is, we have to divide this by characteristic impedance. That is, in our case, it is 50. So if we divide this value, normalized admittance, by 50, we are going to get admittance as 0.002353 minus J of 0.009412. Let's review the impedance and admittance terminology. Impedance is equal to resistance plus J reactance. Z is equal to R plus JX. And admittance is conductance plus J susceptance. Y is equal to G plus JB. On the impedance chart, the correct reflection coefficient is always represented by the vector corresponding to normalized impedance. Charts specifically prepared for admittances are modified to give the correct reflection coefficient in correspondence of admittance. You can see over here, one side is representing impedance, another side is representing the admittance. Let's see what it is. Since related impedance and admittance are on opposite sides of the same Smith chart, the imaginary parts always have different sides. Therefore, a positive inductive reactance corresponds to negative inductive susceptance, while a negative capacitive reactance corresponds to a positive capacitive susceptance. Analytically, the normalized impedance and admittance are related as this one, as shown over here. Next is impedance matching. If the load is real, voltage standing wave pattern at the load is maximum when ZR is greater than Z01, or minimum when ZR is less than Z01. The transformer can be connected directly at the load location or at the distance from the load corresponding to multiple of lambda by 4, as shown in figure. In this lesson, we have learned lossless transmission line, VSWR, Smith chart, and impedance matching. Thank you.